If you've got a problem with your water softener, or if you're intrigued by how ion exchange softeners work, or if you're just curious to understand the strange dance rhythm between the resin and brine tanks, then this video is for you.
All right, so here's the code I got, E2, with that phone message up in the upper left there. Now, I had a chance to look through the dealer service manual. E1 means the motor always turns when it's not supposed to be, and E2 means that the motor or piston is locked in a frozen position. If you get an E3, it means it's a homing error, that is that the cam is unexpectedly in the home position. So if you're having a problem with your system, the first thing you're going to want to do is to bypass the system so you can keep your house water on and then figure out what the problem is. Now, when this system is functioning normally, the cold water comes in here and then goes through the softening and then comes out here to the rest of the house. And normally this red plunger, which says push to bypass, is normally the red thing is sticking out that way and the blue one is all the way in. So to bypass it, all you have to do is you squeeze a little clip and push this red one in. And as the red one pushes in, the blue one pushes out. So let's start with some basic anatomy. This is the brine tank and this is the resin tank. Now the action happens inside the resin tank where your hard water goes in. And molecules that are in the hard water, like calcium and magnesium and iron, mostly positively charged molecules, are bound up to these little resin beads, and then it goes out as soft water. Now the brine tank is full of these pellets that you buy at the store every month or so, and you replenish them, and the purpose of this tank is to put those sodium molecules into solution and displace the calcium and magnesium from the resin and replenish it every once in a while. Okay, so let me show you the board. This gray wire here is to a flow control, and this is run with 24 volts of AC voltage. All right, so let's look at this more closely. I find this fascinating, and the more I look at it, the more fascinating it becomes. This is a little 24 volt shaded pole motor, and not surprisingly, I'm not getting 24 volts here because I think the system has turned itself off because it's got this trouble code running. Now, if you look at closely, you've got a couple of micro switches here, and at least one of those works properly. And if you look at this, you've got a camshaft here with a bunch of notches in it. And the motor evidently turns that whole apparatus, pushing plungers in and out and turning this camshaft. Now, the other thing you'll notice is that there's a lot of calcification here. You see all this calcification? And I think putting this together, I think the most likely scenario is that we've got a problem with a frozen piston somewhere, and it's created a lot of resistance. And one of the weaknesses of shaded pole motors is that they tend to seize up easy. They don't have a lot of torque. And so what my working plan is to take this all apart, clean it, get rid of a lot of the calcification, have a look at the seals, and put it back together again, and then hope it works. Before taking it apart, let's unplug it. Dealer's manual says to start at the top. These little switches here look to be working normally. There's no calcification around them. There's a little circlip in here. I'm just going to pry that off. Nice to have a screwdriver tip that's magnetic. Now this cam should be able to just lift off. I'll just remember the position it was in. There we are.
I didn't get a good shot of this when it went back on, so I'll show you this now. Under the cam, there's an offset diagonal slot, shown with the yellow arrows, into which an offset roll pin on the shaft, shown with the red arrow, needs to mate up. In addition, notice behind this is the adductor piston shaft with a raised bump, shown with the yellow arrow, that needs to ride inside a groove on the undersurface of the cam, shown with the green arrow. When you reinstall, it's possible to accidentally rotate that adductor piston shaft upside down, so you need to be sure that the raised bump on the piston shaft mates properly with the undersurface of the cam. Dealer manual says next step is to remove this screw right here. I moved you down in a little closer to see these two big screws here, one here and one there. They say to take those off now. Okay, this just dropped off. There we are. These motor support bolts are T20. So there's the shaded pole right there. For more details about how this motor works, if you go to my channel, I did one on an oven shaded pole motor and I showed how it works and everything.
It's a fascinating mechanism.
The hardest part of this is getting the seal pack out. If I had to do this again, I'd use a different method. In my case, I got away with it, but it's not wise to grip the shaft in the teeth of unprotected pliers. A better method would be to get a pair of needle nose pliers and hold them sideways across the slot in the end pin, and then pull. I tried rotating the seal pack and lubricating with silicone spray, but I made the mistake of rotating counterclockwise, and the seal pack inside came undone.
All right, well, it was off camera, but I pulled it and it just suddenly let loose here. And it looks like only part of it has come out.
At that point, I doused the inside with silicone spray and then re-threaded the packs together. And then I was able to pull the whole thing out as a unit.
Yeehaw! Ooh, look at all that grunge. Some kind of a sleeve. That looks like the nozzle down below it. There, that's the adductor nozzle right there.
The first thing I wondered about was whether or not the gears are wrecked inside of this thing. And when you spin it, you can't really see much movement here. But remember that these shaded pole motors, they spin at about 3,500 RPMs. And so I'm going to use my drill to spin the squirrel cage of the shaded pole motor. And we'll see if this little white arm moves. Okay, we're on there now. And you watch for me. And yes, it's definitely moving. Now here's the seal body. And there's this little plunger inside. And it turns out these things screw on. And so if you're pulling this out and you're having trouble getting it out, make sure you turn clockwise rather than counterclockwise in this part here, because it's all threaded together. And then if you do take it apart, remember, there's some asymmetry here. The wide section here is on the outside, and then there's a narrow, and then there's a wide one here. There's, see that spacer right there? And so I've got to make sure I don't mess this up and get the sequencing wrong. So we'll take this end off now. I've got the small part sitting in a pail with acetic acid to try and dissolve off the iron deposit. So, and you can see there's a seal that's torn. You see that?
Alright, so I took the whole thing apart, soaked it in acetic acid for a while, used the toothbrush and scrubbed them as best I could, took the seals out. There are little white seals here, about six of them all together, all on the inside. And the main issue I find is that there are three of the seals that have little tears in them. Now, sadly, Culligan don't sell seals by themselves. They're worth about 10 cents, but they don't sell them by themselves. They sell this entire body. In Canada, it's worth about $270 plus some change and tax and things, which is exorbitant when you consider the fact that all we're looking for are the seals. And so I've spent some time lubricating this up, and what I've used is silicone paste. This is the same stuff that's used for brake caliper slides. It's a type of grease. It never hardens. Now, one thing about shaded pole motors is they spin the wrong way if you put them on upside down. And so I remember the sticker was underneath, and so it's going to go on like this. You've got to put the motor on at this stage, because if you don't put it on at this stage, you won't be able to get that second nut on later. You remember that little plunger, that the piston needs to dovetail in here, And the other part that the motor ties into needs to dovetail in here, and so you need to get the lengths just right. Let's see if I can do it here. Ah, yeah, there we are. And I'll just tighten those big screws up.
So how does this actually work? Here's a schematic diagram. On the lower left is the camshaft, and you can see the adductor piston rides on the camshaft. The camshaft also moves the seal pack assembly with its piston, shown on the right to make the drawing easier. This is the home position, where the system spends a majority of its time. You can see the resin tank is in series with your home water supply, and nothing is moving through the brine tank. Every couple of weeks, the system needs to regenerate, and during that whole process, the system is effectively bypassed, so you get about 90 minutes of hard water while the system is regenerating. The first step is the backwash phase, where incoming water is pushed backwards through the outlet of the resin tank, then out the inlet, and finally spilled down the drain. That takes about 20 minutes in my unit. After that, my unit has a 58-minute regenerate draw phase, where all the salty water in the brine tank is drawn by the adductor venturi into the resin tank, flushing the resin tank and discarding that water down the drain. So impurities in your hard water largely get flushed down the floor drain of your basement. Finally, there's a rinse and refill phase, where the resin tank is flushed out and incoming water is pumped back into the brine tank in preparation for the next cycle a couple of weeks down the road, when fresh brine will be needed again. Okay, so right now we're in the home position. I got here through the status screen. You press status till you get to a blank page, and then you hit a plus, and that takes you to the home position. Now we're going to scroll through each of the other positions and make sure they work. First, you press and hold the regen button. I find if I don't hold it for long enough, sometimes it doesn't kip in. There, and it's moving to the regen position now. So the camshaft is obviously working normally. And this is in the regeneration phase. We've got water leaking out the drain, and you can hear water flowing. So when the camshaft is there, the big bump here, and the switch is there in that position, that's a regeneration phase. Now let's scroll through to the brine draw slow rinse phase. To do that, I hit a plus. And it moves. You see how it's moved? Now we're in the brine draw slow rinse phase. And then from here, we're going to go to the fast rinse phase. Water's still draining here. Okay, so fast rinse phase is just a bit of a shift. The big bump of the camshaft is almost directly back that way. And you can hear water draining out the drain. And we're on number 3 at the moment. And then we'll hit a plus and go back to the home page again. Okay, so the temporary plan over the next few weeks when the brine settles is to clean out the brine tank. I haven't done that yet. Now, the thing that surprised me most about this repair is the fact that it actually worked. As you know, I didn't replace those seals. I just flipped them around, cleaned them up, and put them into different positions. And to my surprise, it's actually worked. There's no leakage at all. And so we've got a temporary fix for the time being anyway. And we'll have to see how long that goes. Now, the second thing that's got me a little concerned is that there's a lot of rust in the whole system. And I expect that same process is going on inside the resin tank. Now, there's a process you can do when the resin starts to expire. You can do a thing called rebedding of the tank, but that costs about $100 or so in parts. And with the question mark as far as the seal body, I don't know if I want to do that right now. There is a temporizing thing I'm going to do, though. I'm going to add a compound called Rust Out. I've never used it before, but you add it in, it's a powder, you add it in between bags, and you try and systemically dissolve the rust out. It's said to be safe for human consumption and designed for people who have wells like I do. In any case, I appreciate you watching. Thanks for coming along.